Friday lecture series of the American Asian Research Institute. Tonight is actually the first one for this academic year. And I'm really interested that we can start this with a very interesting lecture about Einstein and his receptivity and his theory within China. As you know, this is the year, the centennial of Einstein's groundbreaking publication of three of his fantastic ideas. I will leave it to Professor Hu to talk more about it, but this is really significant that this is the year, and we do have Professor Hu to come to talk to us about that. Professor Hu is teaching at the City College of New York. He is teaching at the History Department at the Asian Studies Department. Before this, he was educated in China in Beijing Jiao Tong University. He got his PhD from Yale University, and he's teaching East Asian Science and Technology, Nuclear Weapons Programs in Asia, History of the Cultural Revolution, etc. at the City College. His current research interests include the history of science and technology in modern China, as well as scientific exchanges between China, Japan, and the West in the 20th century. Recently, he just published his book, China and Albert Einstein, by Harvard University Press. Please welcome Professor Danian Hu.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Tan, for your very kind introduction. It's my honor to be invited by Ari to report my recent research on the Chinese reception of Albert Einstein and his theory of relativity. As many of you know, this year has been designated by the UN as the World Year of Physics in commemoration of Einstein's great contributions in 1905, including the creation of the special theory of relativity. This World Year of Physics has seen in China a series of celebrating events promoting Albert Einstein, the theory of relativity, and other achievements of modern physics. Last April, the celebration reached a high point in the international project named Physics Enlightened the World. On the evening of April 18, 2005, the 50th anniversary of Einstein's death, a light emerged in Princeton, New Jersey, forming the seed for a grand optical relay that eventually embraced the whole globe, uniting all nations through the enlightening power of physics. Both mainland China and both Taiwan and mainland China joined the relay. Here, this is the picture on the Taipei 101 and during the relay. In mainland alone, the light of physics passed through 34 cities and was witnessed by more than 100,000 college and secondary school students before it was passed, transmitted to Russia with this image. This and other ongoing celebrations have once again demonstrated the strong and deep Chinese admiration of Einstein and his achievements. I emphasize once again because the Chinese had voiced a similar kind of intense admiration as early as 85 years ago in 1920. Today, I'd like to give you a brief review on the history of the Chinese reception of Einstein and the theory of relativity. Two Japanese educated Chinese scholars first introduced Einstein's theory of relativity into China in the year 1917. This simple statement contains three remarkable points. The first is about the two introducers, whose names were Xu Chongqing and Li Fangbai. Xu was a philosopher. This is Xu Chongqing on the left. Xu was a philosopher and educator, schooled in Japan between 1905 and 1920. He first studied neo-Kantian philosophy, then Kantian sociology, and finally settled on Herbartian education. It was during a philosophical debate with Cai Yuanpei, the then president of Peking University, that Xu cited the special theory of relativity. Therefore, the first ever appearance of a special relativity in Chinese literature. Xu seemed to have learned from popular works popular and philosophical works by Max Planck, Henri Poincaré, and Arthur Schuster. The second introducer, Li Fangbai, who studied in Japan between 1910 and 1917, was a physicist trained at the Tokyo School of Physics. Li gave a public lecture in central China late in 1917, which, though titled Newtonian and Non-Newtonian Dynamics, actually introduced special relativity. Li's introduction was apparently adapted from a paper written by two American scientists, Gilbert Lewis and Richard Tauman. Another remarkable point for the beginning statement is the significant role Japan played in this early development. Why was relativity introduced from Japan? The answer has two parts. First, there was a mass presence of Chinese students in Japan at the beginning of the 20th century. As you may see from these statistics, there were at least several thousand Chinese students studying in Japan each year between 1905 and 1911. Let's see, 1905 and 1911, at least over 2,000 students each year staying in Japan. Second, the Japanese physicist had an early interest in special relativity. For example, Ayao Kawaki here began to study relativity before 1907, while Ishiwara Yung, the lower picture, published his first research paper on relativity in 1909. In contrast, German physicist Max Born, one of the most engaging and authoritative expositors of relativity in the West, did not even know special relativity until sometime between 1907 and 1908. So the Japanese physicist was even compared to the European physicist was rather early in accepting the theory and studying the theory of relativity. The third remarkable point about the beginning statement is about the timing of the introduction. Why did it take place in the year 1917? My investigation demonstrates that it was clearly stimulated by the May 4th movement, the most important intellectual revolution in modern China, which promoted the introduction of Western culture, especially Western sciences. May 4th movement not only stimulated the introduction of relativity, but also facilitated its swift reception. The aspiration for Western science led to the establishment of numerous organizations and publications dedicated to introducing, studying, and promoting new scientific theories such as relativity. During the movement, many celebrated Western scholars were invited to lecture in China. Both Bertrand Russell and Albert Einstein were invited. Russell, the British philosopher and mathematician, presented a series of lectures on relativity in Beijing early in 1921. Einstein stopped by Shanghai on his way to Japan. And Einstein planned to visit Peking University at the end of 1922, but later canceled his trip because of a series of misunderstandings. Nevertheless, both events greatly helped the theory's dissemination in China. As you can see from this chart, both Russell's lectures in 1921 and Einstein's planned visit at the end of 1922, both events prompted sharp increase of Chinese publications on relativity. As a result, the theory of relativity and Albert Einstein became widely known in China in the early 1920s. In the 1920s, the Chinese quickly absorbed the theory of relativity virtually without any controversy. This was partly because the theory's revolutionary implications, which made it particularly attractive for intellectuals engaged with the revolutionary fervent of the May 4th period. Russell strengthened the revolutionary image when he acclaimed during his tour in East Asia that Vladimir Lenin and Albert Einstein were two of the greatest living figures in the world at the time. It is therefore not surprising that Zhang Songyan, showing here on the top, who was a lifelong follower of Bertrand Russell, was among the first in China to call relativity, quote, a revolutionary new physical theory, end quote. And Zhang also think the relativity launched a revolution in science. Zhang Shenfu, was one of the founding members of the Chinese Communist Party in the 1920s, who later proclaimed himself as an admirer of three famous Jews, Karl Marx, Freud, and Albert Einstein. Because of their he admired them because of their revolutionary contributions to Western thought. Perhaps a more important reason for the quick and non-controversial Chinese reception of relativity was the absence in China a tradition of classical physics. China went through a long and slow process of scientific enlightenment from the end of the 16th century to the early 20th century. During the three centuries, Western knowledge of physics was gradually introduced into China through translated scientific works. But the introduction was sporadic, incomplete, and mostly utilitarian. None of the major works by Copernicus, Galileo, Newton, and Maxwell were ever translated in their entirety. There was no systematic teaching or research in classical physics in China. Consequently, despite the rich and historically significant introduction to classical physics before the 20th century, the conceptual system of classical physics never became a significant component in Chinese thought before the introduction of the theory of relativity. Furthermore, the modern school education, in which physics would become part of the regular curriculum, was not carried out as a national policy until 1905, the miraculous year of Einstein. The new school system, especially college education, was not adequately developed until the late 1920s. Consequently, the first generation of Chinese physicists pursued advanced studies overseas, mostly after 1905. They began to return home in the late 1910s, founded modern physics instruction in China, and trained the next generation of Chinese physicists. Almost all early Chinese physicists, therefore, established their careers in the post-relativity era, when the classical conceptual system was seriously shaken. This unique background made Chinese physicists more susceptible to new ideas and contributed to their non-controversial acceptance of the theory of relativity. In my investigation, I have not discovered a single Chinese physicist or mathematician between the 1920s and the 1940s who publicly raised opposition to the theory of relativity. There was only one single critical essay published during this period, but it was a translated paper by Hans Derisch, here showing on this picture, who was a German embryologist and philosopher who visited China in the early 1920s. What is more interesting is that its translator, the essay's translator, Zhang Junmai, shown here on your right. Zhang Junmai, who was a conservative Chinese philosopher who translated that essay. But Zhang actually disagreed on Derisch's criticism, such widespread receptiveness again among the Chinese supports Wei Siluan's reflection. Wei was among the first in China to study relativity in the early 1920s. Wei argued, based on his own experience in studying the theory of relativity, that it was easier for Chinese scientists to accept the revolutionary new concept, such as the relativity of time, a key step in understanding the theory of relativity, because unlike their European counterparts, they did not insist on maintaining the Newtonian concept of absolute time. Wei further speculated in 1922 that non-prejudiced Chinese scientists could make faster progress in science. Indeed, only 5 years later, the first Chinese theoretical physicist began to emerge in the United States, and the two of them specialized in the study of general relativity, cosmology, and even unified field theory. These two theorists were Pei Yuan Chou and Shu Xingbei, or Xingbei So. Yeah. Inspired by the great success of relativity, widely reported by the Chinese media in the early 1920s, both men chose a career as a physicist, and both carried on their research even during the war against the Japanese invasion in the late 1930s and early 1940s, when many Western theorists had moved away from such study and flocked into a more popular research in nuclear physics. Chou even spent his sabbatical in Princeton, New Jersey, to join in a small international group of theorists to work with Einstein in person on general relativity. The works of Chou and So represented the rise of theoretical physics studies in China. Both of them also educated the next generation of Chinese theoretical physicists, among whom the most well-known are Xian Yang and T.D. Li, the two Nobel laureate in physics in 1957. A little known but more remarkable student of Zhou was Danian Hu, who was the first physicist to apply the Einstein-Infeld-Hoffman method to the problem of gravitational wave emission in the year 1947. Between the late 1940s and the early 1950s, East Asia experienced dramatic political changes. Among the most important events were the establishment of the People's Republic of China and the Korean War. As consequences of this development, China was largely isolated from the West, and the PRC government adopted a leaning to one side, meaning the Soviet Union policy, in the 1950s. Such a policy may have helped to break the US-led blockade, but it also subjected the country to a prevalent influence of Stalinism. As a result, Soviet-derived political and philosophical criticism of Einstein and the theory of relativity were introduced and spread in China. Gradually, the imported Soviet criticism not only tarnished the previously glorious and revolutionary images of Einstein and his theory, but also induced the indigenous criticism, likewise in the name of upholding Marxist dialectical materialism. Such deterioration in the opinion on Einstein has been clearly demonstrated in relevant reports in the People's Daily, one of the country's most influential and authoritative newspapers since the late 1940s. The paper was found in 1946. In the next year, 1947, Einstein appeared for the first time in the paper. And the paper in 1947 called Einstein the world's most renowned progressive scientist, whose Einstein's protest against US militarism was applauded. But 5 years later, the opinion changed. In 1952, editors of the official organ of the Chinese Academy of Sciences made a public self-criticism, and that self-criticism was published in the People's Daily. And they made that self-criticism for having, quote, side with Einstein, end quote. What did they do wrong? They had pointed out, the editors of the from the Chinese Academy of Sciences, they pointed out in a footnote an error in the criticism article authored by a Soviet philosopher, M.M. Karpov, in which Karpov accused Einstein of being, quote, a thoroughgoing idealist, end quote. In 1953, Yuri Zhdanov's article was translated, in which he condemned Einstein's interpretation of his relativity as Marxism and agnosticism. In the following year, Soviet academician S.L. Sobolev's essay was rendered into Chinese, indicating modified Soviet view on Einstein in the aftermath of Stalin's death. Sobolev admitted that relativity and other scientific contributions of Einstein were quote-unquote rational, but he still maintained that it was completely correct to criticize Einstein's confusing and idealist worldview. By the mid-1950s, translated books or articles that condemned Einstein as an idealist and reactionary were widely available in China. Largely imitating their Soviet big brothers, the Chinese critics had also focused on Einstein's philosophical views in the 1950s and early 1960s. Following Vladimir Lenin's disparaging remarks on German physical chemist Oswald in 1908, the critics often marked Einstein as, quote, an eminent scientist but poor philosopher, end quote. In general, Chinese physicists had stood aloof from the philosophical criticism during this period. But sometimes they might have been forced to take a stand. To illustrate this matter, I want to use Pei Yuan Chao's experience as an example. When Einstein passed away in 1955, Professor Chao, now the president of the Chinese Physical Society, quickly telegraphed his heartfelt condolences on behalf of Chinese physicists to Einstein's family, which was done reportedly under Premier Zhou Enlai's instruction. On the very same day of sending his telegraph, Chou published an article in the People's Daily, calling Einstein the greatest contemporary physicist, praising his love of science and humanity, his opposition to German militarism, fascism, and American imperialism, and Einstein's untiring work for the cause of peace, democracy, and freedom. A couple of weeks later, Zhou published another memorial essay in which he extolled Einstein's contributions to physics and praised him for his pacifism and for his courageous struggle against Marxism. It is, however, remarkable to know that in this second essay, critical remarks were added at the end of the last paragraph, in which Einstein was characterized as a spontaneous materialist who could discover physical laws, but his philosophical interpretation of his physical discoveries were often based on idealist viewpoints. The author called on Chinese physicists to criticize Einstein's idealist viewpoints and step up the study of Marxism and master the dialectical materialist worldview and method of thinking. The year of 1956 was a turning point. Khrushchev's open criticism of Stalin and the Lysenko affair forced the Chinese leaders to reconsider the country's policy of learning comprehensively from the Soviet Union. The Chinese Academy of Sciences was instructed to investigate the impact of Lysenkoism in China, leading to the significant Qingdao Symposium on Genetics in August 1956, designed to encourage free debate on scientific issues. At the symposium, Yu Guangyuan, showing here the picture, who was a high-ranking official of the CCP's propaganda department and a former physics student of Professor Peiyuan Chou, Yu censured at the symposium, Yu censured A.A. Maximov's philosophical criticism of Einstein. A.A. Maximov was a philosopher in Soviet Union. In my Yu's speech, in my opinion, this kind of criticism is not helpful for physics. It only creates confusion and hinders the development of natural sciences. We would rather have one Einstein than 100 philosophers of this kind. Philosophy can provide guidance to science and therefore has a great responsibility. Philosophers should never be allowed to make casual criticism of scientists. Meanwhile, in the post-Stalin Soviet Union, a strong majority of Stalinist philosophers adopted more moderate ways of looking at Einstein's elaborate theoretical structure. In the 1960s, Soviet philosophers even canceled their previous accusations against Einstein and tried to demonstrate the essential affinity of Einstein's theories to Marxist ideology. But these changes, ironically, had little influence on their former Chinese comrades, because the Chinese had publicly broken with the Soviets in 1960s. As a result, the Soviets, whose influence in China was abating in the late 1950s, had become a revisionist by the early 1960s, and therefore not only should never be followed, but also deemed to be condemned. In China, the liberal policy indicated in Yu's speech here was never the liberal policy indicated in Yu's speech did not seem to reflect a party consensus, because the speech was never published until nearly 30 years later. In fact, radical campaigns such as the anti-rightist movement almost immediately followed, preventing the creation of a necessary democratic environment for the development of Chinese science. The political situation in China became even more turbulent in the mid-1960s, when earlier criticism not only resurfaced, but also evolved into far more radical attacks during the Cultural Revolution. Let's assume.
To the columns of China's main newspaper, he called on young people to attack party officials and replace them with true revolutionaries. How to unleash the great military and cultural revolution? To attack Western influences and to destroy the four olds, old ideas, old culture, old customs, old habits. Without this destruction, he said, socialism cannot be achieved. The Red Guards tore down street signs and put up new revolutionary names. They ransacked museums, libraries, and temples. They searched and looted people's homes.
Before and after every action, we use Mao's songs and quotations to encourage ourselves.
Several people died in each battle.
In Beijing, embassies were attacked. Rebel factions occupied the foreign ministry for 2 weeks. The violence Mao had unleashed had spiraled beyond even his control. He described the summer of 1967 as utter chaos and all-out civil war.
Now, as you can clearly see from these movie clips, the Cultural Revolution was nothing less than a tragic calamity and had perhaps the most ruinous effect on Chinese society. It plunged the country into an unprecedented turmoil and destroyed most of its cultural establishments. Chinese science and scientists were among those that suffered most. Beginning in 1968, in an organized criticism campaign, Einstein was not only assaulted in his political and philosophical views, but also on his scientific theories. The campaign began in Beijing in 1968 and later expanded in Shanghai in the early 1970s. The critics consisted of mainly physicists, engineers, philosophers, and journalists of the younger generation, who accused relativity of being based on a groundless hypothesis and advocating reactionary idealist relativism and bourgeois viewpoints, and representing one of the biggest obstacles now blocking the advance of natural sciences. Radical party propagandists such as Chen Boda and Yao Wenyuan sponsored and exploited criticism campaign for their own political gains. While Chen supported the campaign out of a political ambition and cultural prejudice, Yao exploited to attack his political rival, Premier Zhou Enlai, and to maintain the absolute control of Chinese science by orthodox Marxist ideology. Even under these extreme adverse circumstances, there were still a few Chinese physicists who took the risk to resist the criticism campaign. Here I show the two physicists, Professor Pei Yuanzhou in Beijing and Tongqing Chao in Shanghai. Both of them did their best to try to resist the criticism campaign. The campaign largely ended in 1976 after both radical leaders, Yao Wenyuan and Chen Boda, after both of them fell from power, but not before it inflicted serious damage to Chinese science and scientific education. The organized criticism of Einstein and relativity was a part of the larger anti-scientific campaign during the Cultural Revolution, which encouraged a nihilistic attitude toward basic scientific research. As a consequence, scientific research institutes were dismantled, and researchers were driven away to work in factories or on farms. By 1970, basic scientific research, especially theoretical research, had nearly vanished from China. Premier Zhou Enlai endeavored to rescue Chinese science from this dangerous situation in the early 1970s, but the attacks by Yao Wenyuan and other radicals prevented it from quick and substantial improvement before the end of the Cultural Revolution. To be sure, the criticism campaign also had some unexpected consequences. The organized campaign allowed some physicists to resume scientific research and gain access to Western scientific literature. It cleared the way for the publication of the three-volume Chinese translation of the collected works of Einstein, and it presented the opportunity for Chinese astronomers to turn a meeting of mass criticism into a national scientific conference. Ironically, the publications against Einstein constituted a rare and publicly accessible source for young Chinese to learn about contemporary discoveries in physics in the early 1970s, which, despite the distortions, inevitably aroused curiosity about modern physics and motivated many to seek more information. Late in 1976, the notorious radical leaders known as the Gang of Four were arrested, and the turbulent Cultural Revolution was finally drawn to a close. Almost immediately, some Chinese physicists began to plan a grand ceremony for the centennial anniversary of Einstein's birth in 1979. A main goal of such ceremony was to publicly rehabilitate the great physicist. Qu Liangying, showing here on the upper left, she was a physicist turned historian of science, who first proposed such a ceremony, and the proposal was eventually approved in person by Deng Xiaoping, who himself just returned to power after twice being persecuted during the Cultural Revolution. The ceremony was also designed convened ahead of other major celebrations around the world. So although Einstein's birthday was in March, in the mid-March, but the Chinese ceremony convened in the late February. On February 20th, 1979, more than 1,000 Chinese scientists assembled in Beijing to honor Albert Einstein. Pei Yuanzhou, now the chairman of the Chinese Association of Science and Technology, gave the keynote speech here. Zhou gave the keynote speech in that ceremony. Zhou's speech presented a comprehensive re-evaluation of Einstein and an official condemnation of the criticism campaign during the Cultural Revolution. Zhou praised Einstein's lifelong scientific achievements, refuted the malicious charges against him, and most significantly extolled his social democratic ideas. And since then, Albert Einstein has not only been restored as a great scientific hero, but also esteemed as a champion of social democracy and justice, social justice. This year, as we've seen from at the beginning, the Chinese celebrated again Einstein's centennial anniversary, the anniversary of his miraculous contribution to modern physics. One may ask, what is the significance of this Chinese celebrations on Einstein? Before telling you my opinion, I'd like to share with you an Einstein story. In April 1929, a mass meeting took place in New York City to pay tribute to Albert Einstein on his 50th birthday. Among the distinguished guests were famous physicist Michelson and special representative of U.S. President and many other celebrities. Upon hearing the news of the mass celebrations, Einstein sent a message from Berlin to his American audience. "You meet to celebrate a myth bearing my name. This proves, however, that in our time, amid all the ill-omened striving after power and luxury, there still lives an appreciation for the eternal aims of the human spirit. That makes me happy. Pursuing the eternal aims of the human spirit is the essential quality of natural sciences. Clearly, the significance of the Chinese celebrations also lies in the demonstrated appreciation for natural sciences, and especially for physics. Such demonstrations are important for young students in China nowadays because the passion for studies in basic sciences is abating among them. In the 1980s, physics, chemistry, and mathematics were among the most popular college majors. But in recent years, the best students have reportedly gone to study economy, business management, and law. This recent trend, if true, may hurt the country's effort in advancing its scientific status in the world. Consequently, it is important to continue to motivate young talents to join the scientific enterprise and to explore the eternal natural world. To find the best way to achieve that goal is a worldwide challenge. Some Chinese media and government officials have recently promoted basic sciences by calling for, quote, the march to the Nobel Prize, end quote. But I think that it would be wiser for us, for the Chinese administrator, to remember Einstein's prudent advice. The progress of science originates from man's quest for knowledge and rarely from his pursuit of practical objectives. Science will stagnate if it is made to serve practical goals. Thank you. I'd be happy to answer some questions you have.
Yes.
Yes, hi. I'm sorry I can't be late. I'm even intentionally on here with the Climate Biomarker Institute. But I specifically came for your lecture today because I'm a physicist by background.
Oh, and thank
that,
you.
And I'm really, oops. Is that an answer? I'm really quite, it's quite interesting the way you presented it, because actually my mentor is Chinese, and I did my master's in astronomy, and my mentor was Frank Xu. And at that time I worked with Tian Yang as well. I was in a movie with him. Mm-hmm. I was also at MIT with C.C. Lin. So I had a lot of Asian and Chinese mentors in physics. Uh-huh. And now you're telling me it was a relatively new field, which is interesting. But the other thing that's interesting is, I think there was a difference between what was happening in China and what was happening in Taiwan. Because a lot of the Chinese mentors that I was encountering were really coming from like Taiwan and not from China. And I didn't really realize what was going on. You gave me a perspective because I was active in that area back in the late 60s and early 70s when that Cultural Revolution was going on. But as you were mentioning things, it reminded me of things that my advisor would say, Frank Xu, okay, at that time, related to the way he was thinking. The other thing too that is also, that you brought out the history of relativity. And that was a period in the late 1800s and early 1900s where there was a change from within philosophy, within the philosophy of absolutism versus relativism. So the change was going on not just in science, it was going on in mathematics, it was going on in literature as well. And that, but one of the things that bothered Einstein was that even though it was relatively, he still had to rely on an absolute, which was the speed of light. I'm wondering if there is something in the Chinese philosophy, which I don't understand fully, that might have been more receptive to this idea of relativity versus absolutism, opposed to the technical methodology behind it. Is there something phenomenological within the Chinese culture that talks about relativity?
You mean according to the Chinese tradition, if they have any philosophical thinking that in its nature against the theory of relativity?
No, just a train of thought. Like, for example, within the Western culture in Europe, we were going through a period of realism, and then within art, we went into like surrealism and those relative point of view. Meanwhile, we were developing certain mathematical methods that allowed us to look at different frames of references. So the train of thought, the philosophy, was moving from absolutism to relativism, subjectism. Is the Chinese philosophy more based on subjectism than absolutism that would have made it more receptive. Am I explaining myself?
Yeah, I'm not. I think to have a short answer is no. I don't think in Chinese thought, in the history, not at least not what I'm aware of, any systematic thinking that will put the Chinese thinker or the scientist in a difficult position that they will accept something new that against their tradition. That's not what I study.
Well, nothing new, but the idea of being subjective, that there's no absolute, that there is relative frames of references. That's the whole basis of special relativity that broke the difference.
Okay.
Recently, this psychologist, I think it's at University of Michigan, did some research on the so-called the thinking patterns of the so-called East Asians and the Occidental Europeans. The Western thinking tend to be linear, and the Oriental thinking tend to be much more comprehensive, with a lot of backgrounds that into what the situation is. And yet, his conclusion is that in linear thinking, you had the beginning, and you had the middle, and you had the end. Yes, and that tends to create a certain a conflict of ideas. Whereas the Oriental thinking is much more comprehensive in that they look into a lot more backgrounds than what is in front of them.
And yet
that in that thinking, it tends to hinder the so-called the Western way of a scientific development. Because there is no solid ground on which you stand on, and there's no process which based on what you stand on, and there's no end. I don't know how I can answer your
question. No, I have an idea. I don't want to distract entirely, but that gets to what Einstein was saying as well at that time, the difference between the determinism and versus probability, probabilistic, okay? We're just saying that the Chinese thought is not as deterministic.
Not as a deterministic.
And that allows for different options for probability. That was part of the conflict that Einstein was going through. I mean, at one point he says, I don't believe that God plays dice with dice with the world, meaning that he doesn't take chances. He was looking for an absolute.
Well, in a way, the Hebrew thinking is not really accidental. It has a lot of Oriental features
into
it too.
Okay.
Yeah, Dr. Tan.
I think that in your lecture you point out about Chinese less receptive to the idea of the absolute time that the Newtonian system.
More receptive.
Perhaps a little bit less. And therefore, so for them to accept the relativity. Is easier, and I just thought of something, sort of like a myth that the Chinese likes to talk about when they say that in the mountain you spend 7 days, but in the humankind world it's already 1,000 years. And that certainly is very relativistically speaking, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a kind of a. It's a literary, right.
Two different kind of system.
Although it's not a scientific idea, but it's imagining,
Right, but this is such a popular idea that people would accept the fact that.
That's a good point. It's indicating that the Chinese from the ancient time, the ancient Chinese philosophy or ancient Chinese thought, had this element of this relativism already.
Yes. Was there something culturally based?
Yeah, the culturally. Yeah. So there's nothing for them to feel is difficult, and for the scientists to accept that.
Well, the other point that you made is that again, it might have been the way educational system was developing in China.
Yeah.
But
there's
you
no
really
classical,
cannot
yeah.
rule out like Newtonian physics and understanding relativity. You need to understand
that's right.
Like
Newtonian physics. Yeah, that system naturally, in a sense, I mean, those some critics during the Cultural Revolution were against the relativity.
Well, they were trying some to do exactly what you said. Yeah. They were trying to find a way to
now that came back.
Marxism.
That's a very interesting phenomenon.
The way that they could have done that was
Now with the ideological support. I mean, they based on the Newtonian mechanics, then they criticized the relativity theory. Some of the critics made that kind of mistake. Yes?
I read somewhere that it says that by a well-known mathematician that in China, there's no real science in China, there's technology.
You mean
before? Yeah. From
ancient times.
Until the modern time. There's no science in the sense there's no hypothesis, there's no proof, theoretical, and then the theory that developed behind it, and then so on. And there's always, you observe, and then you do it by trial and error, and what worked, but there's no, it's technology, but there's no science basis.
Yeah.
And recently, in the one top university in China, looking for a faculty position in astrophysics, mm-hmm. but no one wants to take that position, okay? Everyone wants to go into, like you say, where there's quick profit and money. What does that says about Chinese science? Does that mean that the Chinese should ought to go into learning what Western culture and science, the basis of Western culture and science, that is back to the Greek era of Plato's and aristocrats and aristocracies and Socrates and what their philosophy is about, what they think, the pattern of thinking, or way of thinking?
You mean